الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس ليذيقهم بعض الذي عملوا لعلهم يرجعون وقال الله عز وجل ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين أما بعد my dear respected brothers, sisters, scholars, elders those who are here, those who are watching and listening Alhamdulillah بفضل الله عز وجل we have once again been allowed by Allah to unite in this masjid for no other purpose than to worship Allah Wallahi is such a huge ni'mah والحمدلله رب العالمين Today, we want to understand a bit more about this COVID-19 coronavirus, how it develops, how it works, what are the symptoms, how we can respond to it, what should you do, how to self-isolate, what's the Islamic guidance, what is the possible forecast of the near future in regards to public congregations like Jumu'ah and etc. First of all, to understand, this virus has been, according to experts, more than likely transmitted from a particular animal to human beings and then now traveling between from one human to another by the means of traveling through communication, through physical contact, through proximity and etc. And so what happens is when the virus gets into a person's body, it goes and targets for settles in the lungs and it develops in the lungs and its work is in the lungs. And that's why the symptoms which are of coronavirus COVID-19 are to do with the lungs. So from the symptoms is coughing, dry cough, shortness of breath. As you know, the lungs are responsible for breathing. And so if it gets filled up with this virus that increases and replicates itself in the lungs, the breath becomes shorter. And also you will experience a high temperature. And so that's how the virus gets in, and that's how it settles, and these are the symptoms, shortness of breath, coughing, usually dry coughing, and a high temperature. Your body temperature normally is around 36 degrees or nearby. If your temperature is above 37.5, then it's of concern. You should, in fact, seek advice, medical advice from 111, or speaking to someone that you know who has got medical experience. These are the symptoms. Those who are at most risk for this virus, or of this virus, are those who are, unfortunately, those who are quite elderly and have underlying health issues. Okay, so other people, young people, children, mashallah, Allah has given them safety from this, subhanallah. Children are not, in most cases, they're completely unharmed by this. But this is still a concern because a lot of the time someone may be carrying the virus, not affected, not damaged by it because your immune system is able to prevent you from getting harmed by it. However, you may carry and deliver it to somebody else who may be harmed by it. And this is why it's a big concern. This is why it's a big deal because it can travel so fast. And within a matter of months, it came from Wuhan in China all the way across the world now, in America. In fact, in parts of America, in Seattle, in Dallas, they've actually completely canceled all public gatherings, including Salatul Jumu'ah. In Germany also, in Italy, it's in complete lockdown because the way that it travels is from people to people. And so what they've done is separated and put the country into sort of isolation so that people don't communicate, so that the spread is slowed down, delayed as much as possible. Now, if you are feeling any of these symptoms that we just mentioned before, I'll say again for you, cough, dry cough usually, shortness of breath, high temperature, 37.5 or above, you should immediately call 111, get advice, and you should also, even if you can't get medical advice, you should do something called self-isolation. What is self-isolation? You can find this information on the NHS website, the government website, BBC website. Everyone's given various informations. I will summarize for you as well now. Self-isolation is where you make yourself alone in a particular place, meaning your room or your home. If you live alone, then it's fairly quite easy because it's your own home, you live alone. And so whatever shopping you need to get done, ask friends and family for help, or you can do online shopping, but ask them to deliver it at your doorstep and not inside so that there is no physical contact and possibility of transfer. Your bins should be double bagged, they advised. Experts say your bins should be double bagged so that it does not travel or it does not affect the person who's collecting the bins also. If you, however, like most of us do, live with other people, with your parents, with your children, with family, with brothers and sisters, and if you feel these symptoms, and if you've been told to self-isolate, or if you know that you should isolate because of the symptoms, then you should choose a room in the house, one room in the house, which should have a window so there's ventilation and cleansing of the air naturally. And you should also, again, same procedure, you should ask people to provide you or get food delivered to your door. If you need to share the kitchen or the bathroom, then it's advice that you use it after everybody else, and after using it, you clean the services as well. If you use the bathroom similarly, try to be the person that uses it last or afterwards or later and clean the surfaces thereafter so that it does not travel from person to person. These are very important pieces of advice. These are, because it's medical advice, it's also Shari'i advice, because Sharia teaches us to take by precautions and to take by the measures which are for our safety and our security and our the benefits of our health. Alongside with that, of course, we've said how to self-isolate, the method of it. If you're outside, at the moment, it is still not illegal to be in a public space or a public gathering. And so therefore, if you are outside, you should carry tissue with yourself. And if you sneeze or cough, you should block it and then bin it straight away. And then also regularly wash your hands. Wash your hands regularly with soap or with hand wash. Whatever you can use it with, wash it regularly. Even if you don't have that, just to wash your hands regularly is very, very effective, because the way that it travels very, very fast is from surfaces. So someone with a virus touches the rail on the train or on the bus, and then you hold it as well, and then it's on your hand now. Now, it can't go into you through your hand. Subhanallah, the skin is safe in that way. It can't affect you and penetrate your skin. However, your hand touches your face regularly. You fix your glasses like I do sometimes, or you touch your face, or you clean your nose, and that's when it goes in through your nose, through your mouth, through your eyes, and etc. And so it's really important to wash your hands regularly so that it does not transmit from people to people. If somebody says you want to handshake them and they say, sorry, not for today, then do not be offended by this, because this is again medical precaution and there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. There is no contradiction in Islam about medical or viruses being transferring or transmitting. You know, some people claim or may think that because of certain hadith that the concept of traveling and sort of contagious infections is invalid. However, that's not true. In fact, there was a ta'un and a plague at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave guidance about how to deal with plagues, and so therefore we understand that this can happen, and we've had or we've been given the required information with regards to it. Washing your hands, doing wudu regularly is also very beneficial. Now we come to our masajid. Masajid, alhamdulillah, are a big, beautiful place of congregations. But however, because it's a congested, small place with a lot of people in here, and people from all different, alhamdulillah, backgrounds and colors and different countries and different lifestyles, the possibility of transmission is very, very high. Very, very high. And that's why a lot of masajid have cancelled Jumu'ah. And there's also already being discussed amongst ulama and councils of masajid and scholars and etc. We say that if you come to the masjid, alhamdulillah, it's still not illegal, and still, alhamdulillah, the jama'at will be carrying on, and the Jumu'ah will also be carrying on, but we advise the following. Bring your own prayer mat, alhamdulillah, even though there's carpet here, so that you can clean your own mat, and you know that only you've used it, and also it's not there is no transmission through the carpet. Hope that makes sense. Try to bring your own small prayer mat, okay? And then you can take it with you when you go home, and you can carry that wherever you go, alhamdulillah, even if it's just for your face, that's a good start. Try to, inshallah, please, do wudu at home. Go to the bathroom at home before you come to the masjid. Okay, we have got wudu facilities here, but of course, because of advice, we've had to remove all towels. Hand towels, tissue towels are also very hard to get hold of now. We're putting on new hand dryers, and yet it is still preferred for you, even according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, for you to do wudu at home. And bathroom also at home. Please try to do this. Also try to pray your sunnah before and after at home. This is also from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. He used to pray his sunnah at home before and after the fara'id. And so the time that we're spending in the masjid in big congregations is limited. Not just because we are scared or anything like that. So there was, in fact, a story I'll share with you. Once the Umar radiallahu anhu was entering into a city where there was a plague. And the Sahaba were having a discussion. Should we go in or should we not? So one of the Sahaba, some of the Sahaba advised, no, we should not go in. We should return. And so someone asked Umar radiallahu anhu, are you running away from the Qadr of Allah? You're running away from the Qadr of Allah. He said, I am running away from the Qadr of Allah to the Qadr of Allah. So whatever happens is the Qadr of Allah. We need to take our precautions, and that is by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. And so therefore, sunnahs at home, prayer mats we've mentioned, wudu at home, and etc. Temporarily, I've said before as well, we usually have a small nasiha before the Salatul Jum'ah here in the Masjid Dar Ummah. Temporarily, as a precautionary measure, because it's just optional. It's optional. It's not fard. It's not wajib. It's not any emphasized sunnah as such. And so temporarily, that will be uplifted and delayed and postponed until, inshallah, situations normalize once again. Bi-ithnillah Azza wa Jal. And so on and so forth. In the future, there may be a possibility. May Allah save us from that. But there may be a possibility that big congregations may be disallowed temporarily as well. Like is the case in Ireland right now. Like is the case in Scotland right now. Like is the case in Seattle and Dallas and Italy and other places. It can happen. If at any point, any of the masajid need to announce that Jumu'ah will be temporarily paused, don't get upset. Because some people might say, what's this guy and this new kind of dino coming up with? You know, you're changing everything. What's going on? These, you know, mashabs and these mullahs are changing. No, it's nothing like that. It is for your own safety. It is a shari'i decision that muftis and ulama together may have to make at certain points. So do not get upset, number one. In alternation or as an alternative, what can you do? You should pray dhuhr at home. Some ulama have advised that you should pray small congregations where you can. Alhamdulillah, this is also acceptable. Smaller congregations so that it's not completely congested and crowded. These are some of the advices that we have so far. Now, let's understand it from a bit more of a rohani, an Islamic, a Quranic method, which what can we do spiritually to help with a situation like this? Look, Allah Azza wa Jal, no doubt, is the controller, maintainer of every single minutest detail of every single affair. No doubt whatsoever. Allahu la ilaha illahu al-hayy al-qayyum. The one who's there watching and maintaining. Qul lan yusibana illa ma kataballahu lana. Say, O Prophet Muhammad, nothing will afflict us except for what Allah Azza wa Jal has decreed for us. Huwa maulana, he is our one to resort to and rely upon. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And so let the believers rely upon Allah. Of course, this reliance with precautionary measures. Not just without the precautionary measures. This is a misunderstanding of tawakkul. And so our tawakkul is there with Allah Azza wa Jal. We should resort to Allah's help by the sabr wa salah. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believe, ista'inu, seek the help of Allah. Bis sabr, with patience. You will require patience now. Was-salah and dua. And salah to Allah Azza wa Jal. Sabr here, according to some tafsir, is fasting as well. This is a means of seeking Allah's help. But be patient. Make dua sincerely. And then it says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ verily and surely. It's tawqid here. There is no doubt whatsoever. Allah will test us and will test you. بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. He will test you with some fear. And you can see the fear right now. وَالْجُوعِ. And some hunger. You may not feel that now, but there are people across the world who've been feeling this for decades. Alhamdulillah, we live in a very comfortable situation and a fraction of it comes to us and people start to empty out the rolls of as the tissues and everything's gone very, very bizarre right now. And they are hoarding for years in advance. This is also problematic because for you to reduce and hoard what other people need is also not allowed in Islam. If you take all of it, what's the next person supposed to do? This is also okay against the guidelines of Islam. And so therefore, we say that Allah will, this is a test from Allah. Fear, jur, naqs min al-amwal, wealth may be reduced. Wa thamarat, and fruits and vegetations may be reduced. Allah said in the Quran, that did you really think that you will go to Jannah without us testing you again and again? And in fact, the most tested of people were the most pious, the Anbiya, ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ, then those who are closest. And so it is verily and definitely a test from Allah. What should we do? We should be patient. We should return to Allah with dua, with salah, and istighfar. My strongest recommendation for all of us to do right now is to resort to Allah with sincere tawbah. Sincere tawbah. Ya Allah, we have all wronged. And with tawbah, Allah Azza wa Jal can change everything. How so? Where's my evidence? You know the story of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. The story of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam, when Yunus alayhi salam left his people, the azab was above their head. It was literally going to befall them. Allah says, فَلَوْلَا كَانَتْ قَرْيَةٌ آمَنَتْ فَنَفَعَهَا إِيمَانُهَا إِلَّا قَوْمَ يُونُسْ لَمَّا آمَنُوا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُمْ عَذَابَ الْخِزِي فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَتَّعْنَاهُمْ إِلَىٰ حِينٍ. That when azab of Allah is there right above you, it usually doesn't just turn away. It's going to happen. But in the case of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam and his people, they all resorted to Allah with istighfar, a communal istighfar. They all came out and then tawbah and gave back the haqq of everybody that they took from. And Allah Azza wa Jal, kashafna anhum. He took the azab away. And the benefits of istighfar are so many. Allah deters punishments and disasters through istighfar. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. Allah will not punish the entire ummah and destroy them completely as long as they do istighfar. Subhanallah. Allah through istighfar gives you contentment and peace and enjoyment. He says, وَأَنِ اسْتَغْفِرُ رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُ إِلَيْهِ يُمَتِّعْكُمْ مَتَاعًا حَسَنًا إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. That if you do istighfar properly, Allah will give you peace of mind and relaxation and enjoyment. Allah will remove your sins and exchange them with good deeds. As we said last week, إِلَّا مَنْ تَابَ وَآمَنَ وَعَمِلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ. If you do tawbah properly, Allah will change all of your bad deeds into good deeds. Subhanallah. Allah will love you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَيُحِبُّ الْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Allah will turn the nature in your favor if you do proper tawbah. Allah says in the Quran, وَيَا قَوْمِ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيَزِدْكُمْ قُوَّةً إِلَىٰ قُوَّتِكُمْ وَلَا تَتَوَلَّوْا مُجْرِمِينَ. If you do istighfar properly, Allah Azza wa Jal will change the sama and the skies will bring you with healthy rain and He will increase your health and your strength, subhanAllah, with istighfar and tawbah. And Allah Azza wa Jal brings victory and success through tawbah. Allah says in the Quran, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. O Prophet Muhammad, when the help of Allah Azza wa Jal will come and you see the people entering into Islam in crowds, and so what should you do in the meantime, Ya Rasulullah? فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. Praise your Allah and do istighfar. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. Verily He is oft forgiving. وَأَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. الحمد لله حمد الشاكرين ونصلي ونسلم على النبي الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن سائر أصحاب نبيك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك وأنا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت. أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت. أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء بذنبي. فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت. يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث. أصلح لنا شؤوننا كلها ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين. اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. اللهم أيد الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم انصر إخوان المستضعفين في جميع البلاد يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم انصر إخواننا الأغور يا رب العالمين. انصر إخواننا في فلسطين وفي دلهي وفي كشمير وفي اليمن وفي الشام وفي جميع البلاد يا رب العالمين. اللهم احفظ الحرمين الشريفين يا رب العالمين وصل اللهم وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وأقم الصلاة
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة إن الله مع الصابرين ولا تقولوا لمن يقتل في سبيل الله أموات بل أحياء ولكن لا تشعرون ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آمين
إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.